So it is my great pleasure to introduce Domenico Marinucci, who is Professor of Probability and Mathematical Statistics at Roma II. He was actually a chairman there during 8 years, if I'm not mistaken. And his main research interests are devoted to spherical random fields and their application to cosmology. He wrote a book on this subject with Peccati, and he is holding an ERC grant on this subject. He seems to be actually quite serious about the application, since he's a member of the European Space Agency. And since 2016, he's an editor of the Electronic Journal of Statistics. So without further ado, I want to leave him the floor, and I'm looking forward to hear his talk on the geometry of random spherical eigenfunctions.
Okay.
Please, Domenico.
Many thanks for the introduction. Let me share my screen. Can you see it? So, thanks for the introduction. Many thanks for the organizers. It's really a great honor for me to be here, to be invited here. And of course, it's a pity we cannot be there in person, but I've been impressed by the ability with which the organizers managed to make such a nice conference here in these very difficult situations. So, I mean, as has been just said, I'm going to discuss about some recent developments in the geometry of random spherical eigenfunctions. I mean, I'm going to start with the work of many people, but in particular, as far as my own contribution is concerned, this has been obtained by means of joint works, especially with Igor Wigman in King's College, Valentina Gambarota, and Maurizio Rossi. So, what are spherical eigenfunctions? I guess most of you know about it already. I mean, it's basically just solutions of these Helmholtz equations with respect to the spherical Laplacian, which has this form, has nothing special in it that you need to remember. The only take-home message that we need to remember here is the form of the spectrum of the spherical Laplacian, so the sequence of eigenvalues, which has this form L, L plus 1, okay? Today, unfortunately, I won't have time to go really deep into motivations, and actually to go at all into motivations. But just in the beginning, I would like to mention a few reasons why studying spherical eigenfunctions is important. Now, first of all, if some among you has listened on Wednesday by a very, very beautiful talk by Alexander Logonov, then he has learned already that the study of like the zero sets of eigenfunctions is a problem that goes back to the early 19th century, to Chladni, who was sort of trying of visualizing vibration modes of a membrane. And then this, brought even a prize by Napoleon, and then many other people have worked on that, starting with Sophie Germain and Kirchhoff and so on. Then of course, eigenfunctions are very important objects in quantum mechanics, where they represent the state of particles. And it's an idea by Michael Berry that the geometry of a generic eigenfunctions, the mystic eigenfunction with some generic boundary conditions, could be studied by means of looking at random eigenfunctions on the same manifold. Now, from the mathematical point of view, this same idea was taken up by groundbreaking paper by Nazzaro and Sodin and Wigman about 10 years ago. But there is also another route by which one can arrive to study these fields, and is from, which is actually the way I got to it, which is studying spherical random fields, which are of course very important objects also for applications, in particular for cosmology now. And in fact, if you have random fields on the sphere, and this field is isotropic, meaning that its law is invariant to rotation, then it's well known by the spectral representation theorem that the field can be expressed as a weighted sum of these random eigenfunctions. So these eigenfunctions basically are, in some sense, the Fourier components of an isotropic random field on the sphere. The field we're going to take it to be Gaussian, mean zero. Each eigenfunction is normalized to a variance one. And then the covariance structure, if the field is isotropic, is necessarily given by this Legendre polynomial. Okay? So Legendre polynomial are defined by this formula here, which is known as Rodriguez formula. But the only important thing that you should remember, because it's going to be important for what we do next, is that the derivative of these Legendre polynomials at the origin is equal to the eigenvalue, lambda L, this that we've seen before, divided by two, okay? So this is going to play a big role in what we see next. Okay, so we want to study the geometry of these fields. What do we mean by the geometry of these fields? Well, we look at discursion sets. Discursion sets are just the subset of the sphere, for instance, where your random field is above some level. So this A, U, F, M could be also another different manifold. So you just look at the subset of the points where your field is above the level U, okay? And you want to characterize its geometry. So how do you do it? Let's first give an example. So these, for instance, are really simulations of this cosmological sphere, this cosmic microwave background radiation, which unfortunately I cannot discuss. So take the field to be Gaussian normalized to a variance one, okay? So it means clearly that all the field is between minus three and three. So basically this is the original field. Then you start to raise the threshold. So you just look at the region where the regions where the field is above minus two, then minus one, then for instance here zero. So here you see that you have all the gray regions which has been canceled, which is the region where the field was negative, okay? And you're just left with this colored region where the field is above zero. So this subset of the sphere, which is colored, clearly has some geometric property. For instance, it has an area, it has a boundary length, that in this case is called the nodal length. It has some topological features, like the Euler-Poincaré characteristic, the number of connected regions minus the number of holes. Then when you raise the threshold over and over, okay, what happens is clearly more regions become gray, okay? And you get more isolated subsets like small islands. And of course the area changes, the boundary length changes, and the number of connected components change and so on. All these are random quantity and we want to study them. For instance, because in applications like in cosmology, you have random fields, you have some predictions on the probability law. Out of these predictions, you want to compute what to expect for these geometric functionals and then compare these predictions with the data, which is something which is done every day, basically. Okay, so how to characterize these excursion sets? Well, let's make a very simple example. Pretend that your excursion set is just this blue square, okay? Then what you can do is you can compute a cube around this blue square, just looking at the points which are at the distance rho from the square, okay? So this region here, okay? Now you want to compute the area of this cube, okay? So you can do like a Taylor expansion and see that the area is given by three terms, a zero order term, which is just the original area in blue, okay? Then a linear term, which is this orange component here, okay? Which is the boundary times the radius of the tube, okay? Then if you put together these four disks, you get these four corners, you get a disk, so it's pi squared, pi times rho squared. So you have a zero order term, a linear term, and a quadratic term, okay? Now this is a general fact because there is a beautiful formula, very old, from convex geometry called Stein's tube formula that tells you that under minimal regularity conditions, which are met by discursion sets, you can always, in any dimension, expand the tube around these sets by means of this formula where you have powers of the radius of the tube, okay? Then these omega j's, these are just constants. They are the volumes of the balls, some pi's and so on, but you can, you know, neglect the precise meanings, just some universal constants. And then these functionals here, L, N minus J, these are called the intrinsic, they are called Lipschitz-Killing curvatures or intrinsic volumes. So in dimension two, they are area, boundary length, actually half of the boundary length for some normalization region, and Euler-Poincaré characteristics. So number of connected regions minus number of balls. So you can prove that if you have any regular function under some minimal conditions on these excursion sets, you can express the regular functions in terms of these intrinsic volumes, okay? And then as I told you, in general, if you have a manifold in dimension D, these Lipschitz-Killing curvatures are D plus one, okay? So in dimension two, we have three Lipschitz-Killing curvatures, Euler-Poincaré characteristics, half of the boundary length, excursion area, okay? Now, if you have a random field, then clearly the value of these Lipschitz-Killing curvatures for any threshold U is going to be a random quantity. So what we want to do is to study these random quantities. Okay, first thing that you want to do with a random quantity is to study its expected value, okay? Or here we are assuming that you have to, as before, we have to do with Gaussian fields, which are isotropic. Now the first result in the expected value is given by Taylor and Adler, and it's more general than single eigenfunctions. It holds for general Gaussian fields, okay? Now to introduce the result, we need just some more notation. So these things here are called flag coefficients. they are not really important. There are some universal constants. So again, volumes of some balls, some binomial coefficients, just constants that do not depend on the manifold, do not depend on the threshold, do not depend on the field, just constants. Then we have this function rho ku. Now the notation rho is a bit unfortunate because they don't have to do with the radius rho that I introduced before. It's just a name for a function. These are just derivative of the Gaussian distribution. Okay, so in practice, they are a Gaussian density times some polynomials, okay, which are the well-known Hermite polynomials. Okay, so these are functions just of u, which are Hermite polynomials for of order 0 is 1, of order 1 is u, of order 2 is u squared minus 1, of order 3 is u cubed minus 3u. They are just some polynomials times some Gaussian density. Okay, so having established this notation, we can give this very beautiful Gaussian kinematic formula, which in this form is due basically to Taylor and Dabre. You can find it in the book 2007, but it's the outcome of a long process started by Adler in 1980s, basically. Okay, and so you have the following. So you have the Lipschitz-Killing curvature on discursion set of a general Gaussian field on a general manifold. Okay, and you want to look at their expected value. So you can expect, you can imagine that this is a very difficult question because it will depend from on u, which is the threshold you're looking on. Then f, which is the specific field you want to study, and then m, which is the specific manifold you are interested in, okay? But then on the right, the formula is very, very simple because it's just a linear combination of some constants. These constants here are universal. They don't care about the field, don't care about the threshold, don't care about the manifold, just some pi's and numbers, okay? Then the functions rho k of u, these are the functions we just introduced a minute ago. So these are just polynomials times a Gaussian density. So they don't care about the field, they don't care about the manifold. And then what? Then the Lipschitz-Killing curvatures, but not evaluated on the excursion set, which is a very complicated object, but evaluated on the original manifold, which is something very, very simple. So for instance, if M, like in our case, is the sphere S2, okay? So the area is 4 pi, unit sphere. The boundary length is zero, because the sphere has no boundary. The Euler-Poincaré characteristic is 2, and that's it. Because it's known that the Euler-Poincaré characteristic of the sphere is 2. So that's it. So at this stage, you are going to tell me, well, but this cannot be, you must be cheating us. Why? Because the field has disappeared. We have something which is completely decoupled in a bit that depends just on the threshold, which is this bit here, and the bit which depends just on the original manifold, not on the discursion set. So where is the field? Now, the point is the following. The field is here in this superscript F. And what does it mean? Well, the Lipschitz-Killing curvatures are volumes, intrinsic volumes, okay? So they depend on the metric that you're using on your manifold, okay? So the point is that you can define a new metric which is induced in a very simple form by the covariance structure of the field. How is induced this metric? Well, it induces Riemannian form and in the product. Let me give you just a special case to make things a bit simpler. So what you need to do is you have an isotropic random field. This isotropic random field has a covariance function, okay? This covariance function has a derivative at the origin. So imagine that in our case, for instance, you have a covariance function whose derivative at the origin is 9, okay? You take the square root of this derivative at the origin. So if it is 9, it becomes 3. And then your new metric is simply the standard Euclidean metric rescaled by this square root. So it means that it's like that if you have to compute the Lipschitz-Killing curvature rather than on the original sphere of radius 1, you compute it on a sphere of radius square root of lambda L over 2, square root of the covariance at the origin. Okay, so a sphere of radius 3. Okay, so for instance, if you have the area of the sphere is 4 pi when the radius of the sphere is 1. If the radius of the sphere is 3, it's 4 pi times 3 squared, so 4 pi times 9. And that's it. Okay. The boundary length, it was 0, it is still 0. The Euler-Poincaré characteristic, it was 2, it is still 2 because the Euler-Poincaré characteristic is a topological invariant. Okay, so that's it. That's all you need to compute the expected value, just to rescale the Lipschitz-Killing curvature by means of this new radius of the sphere and then compute this weighted sign. So this is really a beautiful formula by Taylor and Adler. and works very well in practice. So for instance, on the sphere, in the case that you're interested in, this eigenfunctions and omega functions on the sphere, you have this, for the Euler-Poincaré characteristic, what you have, the leading term is this, it's 4 pi, which is the measure of the sphere, times the derivative of the covariance function of the origin, so this eigenvalue divided by 2, times a function permit polynomials times Gaussian density, okay? Then boundary length, the same 4 pi times now the square root of the eigenvalue times Gaussian density. Then the area, 4 pi times the Gaussian distribution, because this is like the zero order term where you don't take the lattice, okay? Now, so this is the expected value. One note, for instance, again, if you think about Lognos-Torque on Wednesday, so one special case of this geometric function is the length of the zero set, okay? So the bound, the nodal length, which is something very important object in mathematics where a lot of top mathematicians have been working in the last decades, okay? So from this formula, you get a special case, the expected value is this thing here. So it's a square root of the eigenvalue times this constant. Now, Lognov discussed in Wednesday this famous Yauf conjecture, which is 40 years old and that he solved basically in the last few years. This Yauf conjecture is telling you that the Hausdorff measure of the nodal sets, it should be bounded above and below up to some constant by the square root of the eigenvalue. So you see the expected value is consistent, of course, with this conjecture, okay? But to this, we shall come back later to see some further results, okay? Now, because here are some simulations by physicists, which, you know, like 100 samples of these random eigenfunctions. So the red line is the expected value, and the arrow are the simulations. So of course, expected value fits, but now if you want to do probability, it's not enough to study expected value. What you want to study is also like the variance and possibly, for instance, limiting distributions for the fluctuations around the expected value, okay? And then possibly also correlation between the different functions, okay? So you see, for instance, here a nice phenomenon that the variance around the expected value is more or less large, but it's exactly zero for all the functions at u equal to zero. So at the nodal level, the variance seems to disappear, so it seems to be lower order, okay? So in order, the first result that I want to discuss, is this thing that, in this form it's given in a paper with Valentina Cammarota, but it's the outcome of also further works with Igor Wigman and Maurizio Rossi. So the fluctuations of this Lipschitz-Killing curvature around their expected values. So these are the Lipschitz-Killing curvature, these are the expected values. So it looks like for this Gaussian, here we're talking about Gaussian eigenfunctions, we have a formula which is some sort of second order Gaussian kinematic formula, a second order form of the formula Mader and Taylor in the special case of eigenfunctions. Why? Because these fluctuations, they are given by what? Okay, some universal constants, which are these flux coefficients that we had also before. Then some functions just of u, okay, which is the derivative of the function we had before times u. Then some powers of the eigenvalues, okay. And then instead of the 4 pi that we had before, which was the measure of the sphere, we have sort of a random measure of the sphere, which is the integral over the sphere of the second order Hermite polynomial computed in the eigenfunction, okay? So you have that the fluctuations up to a lower order term that goes to zero as L goes to infinity. The fluctuations, for instance, of the Euler-Poincaré characteristic of discursion sets, the boundary length of discursion sets, or the area of discursion sets, are proportional to a very simple random variable, which is just the integral of the square of FL minus its expected value times all deterministic terms, okay? And now this formula has a lot of consequences. First of all, it proves what we have seen in simulations, because you see that all the expressions have a U term here. So it means that when U is equal to zero, so we are in the nodal case, then this leading term disappears. And this explains this disappearance of the variance, which, by the way, usually is called the Berry cancellation phenomenon because it was first noted by Michael Berry in the case of nodal lines. Okay, so first comment, you see that this leading term vanishes at u equal to zero, so the variance is smaller. Second comment, these Lipschitz-Killing curvatures, they're all function of the same random variable, okay? So this means that in the high frequency regime at high eigenvalues, they are perfectly correlated. So if you know one of them, you know all the others. Okay, if you know the area of discursion regions above one, then you know also the boundary length of discursion region above one, and you know also the other Poincaré characteristic of discursion region above one. Okay, and moreover, they are perfectly correlated among different levels. So if you know the discursion area at level one, then you know also the discursion area at level two or level three. You can predict the discursion area at all levels. Okay, and then of course, because the random part is just this, and these are just deterministic terms, it's very, very easy to compute the variance because it's just the square of this deterministic term times the variance of this, which is a trivial computation. Okay. So, you know, there are these things that I noted already, so that that very simple forms written just in terms of the integral of the power of the eigenfunction on the manifold. And then there is this correlation phenomena. And then, of course, there is something to which we shall come back later, because the, what is perhaps the most interesting part from the mathematical point of view, that is the behavior of zero sets, like nodal lines or nodal area, is not covered by this result, because this leading term is disappearing. So we have to cover it later on in this talk. Okay, I mean, Alice this morning said that you cannot give a good talk, at least in France, if you know, don't give at least some hint of a proof. So, I mean, I cannot go against my chairwoman, and so I give just some hint of a proof here. So just some sketch of an idea. So the idea is the following. Let's take some background material. If you have a general Gaussian random variable, and you have a nonlinear transform of this Gaussian random variable, finite variance, okay, so G of Z, then it's well known that this nonlinear transform can be expanded in L2 sense into what? Into Hermite polynomials. So Hermite polynomials, they form an orthonormal basis for the space of nonlinear transform of Gaussian measures. Okay. So in particular, you can write this G of Z as sum of some projection coefficients. Here you just project your nonlinear transform versus Hermite polynomials times the Hermite polynomials themselves. This is just an infinite dimensional projection. Okay. This is true in the case of standard scalar random variables, but it's also true for general Gaussian processes. Okay, so this is what is known as the Wiener Kraus decomposition of random processes. If you have a process which is a nonlinear transformation of a Gaussian measure, okay, then you can write it as the direct sum of Wiener Krauses. Okay, and the Wiener Krauses are basically the space spanned by Hermite polynomials, so product of Hermite polynomials. Okay, so this is like Struck-Vardan formula. This is the result that goes back to the 50s. Now, the nice thing to remember here is that the Hermite polynomials have a very simple covariance structure, which is given by so-called diagram or Wieck formula. So if you take two Hermite polynomials of different order, they are orthogonal, so the covariance is zero. They are an orthonormal basis, so this is not surprising. If they have of the same order, then the covariance is given up to constants by what? By the covariance of the arguments to the power q, okay? So if you do the covariance between polynomial of order three and three with respect to two variables, it's just the covariance of the arguments to the power three. Okay. So why is this result useful in our case? So think, for instance, to the discursion area. Discursion area you can write as the integral on the sphere of the indicator function on the subset u to infinity of your eigenfunction. Okay. Now this is clearly a square integrable function of a Gaussian field. Okay. So this inner function here, this indicator function, you can expand it into Hermite polynomials. Okay, you compute some projection coefficients which have this form, and you expand it into Hermite polynomials. Okay, so in particular, you get the discursion area, which is this object here. You can write as an infinite series of what? Of some deterministic functions of u. Look, they look rather similar to the function that we had before in this Gaussian kinematic formula, because they have a Gaussian density time Hermite polynomials, times what? Times some random variables. These random variables you obtain how? Well, pointwise you have this its expansion, okay? Then you can show that you can interchange the series with the integral, then you get just the integral of this Hermite polynomial computed in this argument, and this is just a random variable, which we call HL of Q, okay? So this means that discursion area we can write as a series of deterministic functions of u times some random variables, h l of q, which we call polyspectrum. Okay? This is an orthogonal expansion, so this gives you immediately the variance of the field. Okay? Now, let's look one more minute to this polyspectra because they are going to be very important in what follows. So for h equal to zero, the zero order midpolynomial is just the constant one. So this integral gives you just the 4 pi, the same 4 pi that we had in the expected value, okay? Then for q equal to one, this is the integral of the eigenfunction. This is exactly zero because the eigenfunctions are orthogonal to constants, okay? Then for q equal to two, this is like the integral of L squared minus one. So basically it's the squared norm of the eigenfunction minus its expected value, okay? For q equal to three is the integral of L three. For q equal to four is this integral of this polynomial and so on and so forth. But they're all very simple objects. Integral of polynomials on the sphere, okay? No derivatives, no second order derivatives, nothing special. Now, what is the very important thing to notice here? The very important thing to notice is that you can compute the variance of these random variables by means of some work, diagram formula, some asymptotic theory, some, you know, there is some work, but you can find these variances. And the variances exhibit some sort of phase transition. So for the first two terms are constant, so the variance is zero. Then the largest variance is for q equal to two, which is of order one over L. For q equal to four is the next largest, is one over L squared times log L. And then all the others are smaller, are all of order one over L squared. So there is this phase transition such that the second order term is the biggest, then it comes the fourth, then all the others are the similar, okay? Now at this point, for the area, everything is solved because if you write the fluctuations of the area around the expected value, what happens is that you have a leading term, which is the second order chaos, plus terms which are negligible, okay? And that's it, because then the variance is going to be asymptotic to this. And also if you want to prove a central limit theorem, it's just a central limit theorem on this random variable, which is very simple, okay? Now, the remarkable thing is that the same thing happens for all the other geometric functions. So for instance, if you have the boundary length, or if you have, let's think for instance, with the other Poincaré characteristic, the other Poincaré characteristic, by means of the Gauss-Bonnet formula, you can write like in terms of the integral of the determinant, the gradient, determinant of the essence, the gradient, and the function, okay? But there are a lot of simplifications that occur in terms of integration by parts. You can do still the expansion for midpolynomials, but in the end, you get that the leading term is just one, and it's the same as before. So the integral, not of the essence, not of the gradient, just the integral of the level of the function, okay? And so this gives you immediately the variance and the central limit theorem. Moreover, one could ask, does the same thing happen for other functions? So I'll be very quick here. For instance, more recently, again, with Camarot and Wigman, we proved the same things happen for the critical points, okay? So if you count the number of critical points above level U, you get another an expansion which has exactly the same form. So it is, you see, let me get here. The number of critical points centered and computed also expected value is some function of U, the eigenvalue, and then the same random variable, which is H2 over L, okay? And of course, this means that also the number of critical points is perfectly correlated with the excursion area and with the boundary length. So in principle, if you know, for instance, the excursion area above level one, you also know the number of critical points above level one. So all these functionals are perfectly correlated. Now, one thing I would like to say very, very quickly, how to prove central limit theorem here. Here you can exploit a really beautiful result, which is due to Nurden and Peccati, which is the following. In general, when you want to prove central limit theorems, what you need to do is method of moments. So to prove that the sequence of your variables, they go, the moments go to the Gaussian moments. Now, Nurden and Peccati have shown that if you work with random variables in the Wiener chaos, so exactly the variables with which we are working, so linear combinations of midpolynomials, then it's enough to show, to study just the fourth moment, so just to show after normalization that the fourth moment goes to three, not only to establish the central limit theorem, but also to show a quantitative version. So you can put some metrics on the space of probability measure, like mass, Stein, or total variation distance. And then if you show that the fourth moment goes to three, then you also have a bound on the rate of convergence in total variation of Bass and Kolmogorov distance of your random variables to the Gaussian to the Gaussian distribution. Okay? So because our variables live in Wiener chaoses, then we can use these tricks and prove not only central limit theorems, but also quantitative central limit theorems with a bound on the distance on these spaces. Okay. And in particular, we can prove quantitative central limit theorem for each of these random variables H and Q with explicit rates. Okay. So not only they are Gaussian, but we can also say the speed to which they go to asymptotic Gaussian distribution. And so, okay, higher dimensional conjecture, I'm going to skip. I'm going to go to the nodal case, okay, which from the mathematical point of view is the one which has driven more attention in the last years. Okay, so what happens in the nodal case? What we said so far doesn't work for the nodal case because we have seen that these leading terms, they disappear exactly in the case u equal to zero. And in some sense, heuristically, you could expect these terms to disappear. Why? Because we see that they've been dominated by the second order chaos. The second order chaos, we've seen that basically are the fluctuations in the random energy of your eigenfunctions. But if you go to zero level, clearly these fluctuations can play no role because the zero remain the same if you change by scale factor the norm of the eigenfunctions, okay? So in fact, because of this, these dominant terms in this for zero statistics, they disappear always. And you have to study different terms, okay? So the first case, let's do again the area, discursion area. So the second order chaos disappears. Actually, all even order chaos disappear, 2, 4, 6, 8, everybody. And so you are just left with a series, okay, of an infinite number of terms, which have all variance 1/square. And some constants which are fairly explicit, they are integrals of the powers of the Bessel function. Okay, so you can know the variance exactly, and so for the 1/square. And by the way, again, the talk by Logunov, he mentioned another conjecture by Yao, saying that for these random spherical harmonics, the ratio between the positive and negative region should be bounded and bounded below for all eigenfunctions. Okay. Here we can prove just with probability one, so weaker result. But with probability one, what happens, thanks to this computation on the variance, is that the ratio between the positive and the negative measure of the eigenfunction goes exactly to one. So the upper and lower constant is actually the same. Okay? With probability one, not for every eigenfunction, but with probability one. And then, same argument here, we can prove also a central limit theorem. Similar to what was before, but I want to go to another issue, which is perhaps more interesting from the mathematical point of view, and that is what happens in the case of the nodal lines, okay? So the zeros of these eigenfunctions. Now, this case was studied first by Wigman in 2010. It's one of the two seminal papers I mentioned in the beginning, okay? So Wigman proved that there is this cancellation phenomenon. So the variance is smaller order than expected. And the variance of the length of the nodal lines is log L over 32 asymptotically. Okay. So in particular, this result by Wigman proves that with probability one, there is some sort of a stronger form of Yao conjecture, just not for all eigenfunctions, but with probability one once again, because the nodal length divided by the square root of the eigenvalue converges to a constant, okay? So the Yao's conjecture was telling you that there were upper and lower bounds. Here, in this probability one, the upper and lower bound is the same. So it converges to the same constant, okay? But here you see that the variance has this log term. So now maybe something's coming back to your mind because when we introduced the polyspectra, if you remember, we saw that the biggest term was the second order term. The next two biggest was the fourth order term with a log L inside, okay? Though the other were smaller order. So one may start to suspect, is it going to be the case that the nodal lines are dominated by the fourth order chaos rather than the second order chaos? And the answer is yes. So here in this paper with Rossi and Wigman, we proved that if you study the fluctuations of the nodal lines with respect to their expected value, what you get is this single random variable, which is just the integral of fourth order polynomial computed in the eigenfunctions, okay? Times, as before, the eigenvalue, the square root of the eigenvalue, times some constant, plus lower order terms, okay? So it's like a further term in the expansion. This is the expected value, then the fluctuations in the norm that dominate at u non-zero, and then at u equal to zero, there is this fourth order chaos that dominates. And so immediately, you have also a center limit theorem, the quantity center limit theorem. By the way, I mean, for brevity in this talk, I've always stick only to random fields on the sphere and dimension two. However, similar results can be given on different manifolds. For instance, actually, before done these results with Peccati and again Rossi and Wigman in 2016, we proved a similar but not completely analogous result for the nodal lines of so-called arithmetic random weights, which are eigenfunctions on the torus. Okay? And the result is similar because it's still the fourth order chaos that dominates, but it's also different because the fourth order chaos on the torus has a more complicated structure. So it depends also on derivatives and second order tables. And then similar results have been given by other people, including, for instance, Durnet, Peccati, Rossi on Euclidean space and Vidotto. I mean, they prove a center limit theorem for the nodal lines with some different techniques. Now, the other issue here is what happens to correlation. So for instance, nodal lines are dominated by the fourth order chaos. If you know the length of the nodal lines, out of it, can you predict the boundary length at non-zero level? Well, the answer clearly is no, because we've seen before that the boundary length at non-zero level is dominated by the second order chaos, and the second order chaos disappear in the fourth order chaos, in the nodal case. However, this conclusion to some extent is a bit misleading, because one could think, okay, the fluctuations in the random node, in the sense they are not the more interesting aspects. What happens if we take away these fluctuations? For instance, if we condition to the random norm of the eigenfunction. And now something interesting happens, because if you take away the fluctuations from the random norm, then you can prove actually that the nodal lines and the boundary length at every level are perfectly correlated. So they have correlation one, okay? So in particular, if you take away the fluctuations of the random norm, then the boundary length at every level is proportional to this thing here, which is exactly this HL4 that we've seen before, the integral of the fourth order polynomial over the sphere, times this deterministic term, which in the special case u equal to zero gives you the constants on the nodal lines. Okay? Now, does this happen for other functions? Well, the other next thing to investigate clearly, for instance, is the total number of critical points or the critical points above zero. Even in that case, the second order chaos disappears. And even in that case, if you look at the total number of critical points, the fluctuations around the expected value are dominated by the same random variable as before, times some constants, times some second order terms which are negligible. So again, there is asymptotically perfect correlation between the total number of critical points and the length of nodal lines. So to sum up, this is closing in 2 minutes, fine? 1 minute or 2 minutes and finishing. So let me give an overview of the results. So if you have u different than zero, okay, then all the Lipschitz Kini curvature and all the critical values are dominated by fluctuations in the random norm. Okay? At u equal to zero, the nodal length and the critical points are dominated by the fourth order chaos, so this integral of the fourth order polynomial over the sphere, okay? For the boundary length, the same happens if you correct for the effect of the random norm. So if you take away the fluctuations in the random norm, such like scaling the eigenvalue, the eigenfunction, then this is dominated by the same random variable. So these three things are perfectly correlated. Nodal length, total critical points, and boundary length. The excursion area is different from all the others because it's dominated by all odd orders causes. So it's uncorrelated with all these other statistics, something which you might expect because, for instance, if you change the sign to your eigenfunction, the nodal lines do not change, okay? The number of critical points doesn't change either, but the excursion area flips its sign. So it clearly cannot be correlated with the nodal lines, okay? So this is a table which gives you the correlation. The take-home message is that these functions, in any case, have very strong correlations among themselves. So for instance, all the Lipschitz-Kini curvatures and the critical points at non-zero levels are perfectly correlated in the high frequency regime, okay? The nodal lines is correlated with the total number of critical values and with the boundary length at different levels if you take away the effect of the random norm. The excursion area is uncorrelated with all the other functions, okay? Very last slide, related works. Now, we have a conjecture, which was even in my slides, but I didn't have time to show it, that the same formula on the sphere holds I mean, the, for non-zero threshold levels, a formula which is analogous holds for spheres of every dimension. Okay, and we have a proof, but it has big gaps and which are not easier to close. So at this stage, it's a conjecture. The interesting question is whether these results hold on different manifolds, and the answer is yes, to a large degree. So a lot of work has been going on arithmetic random waves, which are Rankine functions on the torus, introduced by Rudnick and Wigman a bit more than 10 years ago, where you have similar results. So dominance by the fourth order chaos, actually even in higher dimension. And other similar results also hold for eigenfunctions in Euclidean spaces, for instance, on the plane, okay, in dimension two. My PhD student, Anna Paola Todino, has extended this to local behavior of random eigenfunctions, so shrinking subsets of the sphere. And this is also the same sort of behavior happens. In some ongoing research, we are now considering random fields which are sphere cross time with Maurizio Rossi and Vidotto, or random sphere, again, with Maurizio Rossi, Vidotto, and then Antonio Doraro and Michele Stecconi, or more complicated geometric structures, which are still motivated by cosmology, like these spin spherical harmonics, which are random sections of fiber bundles on the sphere. And similar results also in this case, but not the time to discuss them. That's it. Many thanks for your attention.